It's Anita T from factversfitness.com here to bring you guys more gut health facts that are straight off the book. Today we are going to talk about the ever so popular food comas. I'm sure you guys have all experienced them, and as someone who just finished living in Spain for a while and the siesta culture being popular there, I definitely know it as a part of a lot of people's daily routines. So although you may or may not enjoy them, I'm actually going to discuss with you why a food coma can be a super dangerous thing for you guys and how it can really be damaging the health of your body. So let's get started. Okay guys, so before we dive right into these scary food comas, be sure to subscribe to my channel below. We are just getting started and I need all of your support to bring as much scientific literature to the public as I possibly can, so that I can tell you guys why your food comas are killing you and all that stuff. Okay, great. So are you subscribed yet? Yeah? Perfect. All right, so food comas. Basically, one of the topics of today is inflammation, and that's because food comas and inflammation they're really tied together. And inflammation is a very, very important thing in our lives because if you guys may or may not know, but science is actually discovering inflammation to be the root of disease. And this is, you know, a growing and growing theory. And I'm not talking about the kind of inflammation where, you know, if you stub your toe and it gets inflamed. I mean the really chronic inflammation, how our body is constantly having the immune system activated by, you know, things like poor food choices and chronic daily stressors and all of these other things we're doing with our body. So as I mentioned, chronic inflammation can be a really dangerous thing because it has the power to contribute to chronic illness. But the scary part is that the majority of us are actually in a chronically inflamed state. And so this is a state of chronic low-grade inflammation. So I'm talking about, you know, when you eat a certain food that's not natural to the body, so your immune system has to come check it out. Or when you have a lot of stress and, you know, it's putting too much stress on your body, that'll promote inflammation as well. So there's really a lot of factors that are considered part of our common daily life now, when in reality, they're actually contributing to chronic disease, as you guys may have already guessed. Okay, so that may have freaked some of you guys out a little bit to know that you're kind of constantly doing things that are unhealthy for your body, but don't worry about it. I'm gonna tell you guys exactly how to combat that. And just to give you guys an example of how capable our body is and how much stress it can take and how much defense it has, is we actually create thousands of cancer cells daily that are destroyed by proper immune surveillance and immune functioning. So this is just a normal function that happens in our body, which was a scary stat when I heard about it, but you know, this is typical biology and our bodies just do a really great job of protecting itself. The problem is when our body starts to deteriorate and can't properly perform surveillance and destroy these cells, then these cells begin to proliferate, and that's when we start to get diseases, and that's when we start to get cancer and things like that. And one of the contributors to damaging our body in such a long term is this chronic low-grade inflammation I'm talking about. So that's definitely something to be avoided. So yeah, what does all this have to do with food comas? Well, one of the most common contributors and biggest contributors to this low-grade inflammation is what we eat. And so when we eat something, we get what's called a postprandial inflammatory response. All that means is postprandial, it means after you've eaten, and then inflammatory response. You guys know what that is. And so what's going on there is when you eat certain things, just to make sure you haven't ingested anything that could be damaging to the body or any sort of pathogens or harmful other things, your immune system comes to just check out the situation, survey it, and you know, make sure that your body is protected against anything bad while taking in all of the good. And so the problem actually happens when we eat poor foods that are so foreign to the body that when our body comes to check out the situation, you know, it doesn't recognize a lot of food additives and colorings as food because it's not natural to us. So at that point, our body is going, what is this? And our inflammatory system starts to activate more because it wants to protect our body, because you're putting a foreign object in the body and our immune system perceives these foreign objects as foreign invaders. So that is actually going to increase inflammation quite a bit. And that's how come after you have a really particularly crappy meal, you get extra tired. That is actually an inflammatory response happening in your body. So when you have an inflammatory response, your immune system needs so much energy to run because of course it's gonna take precedence over anything else in your body. It's defending your body. So it's going to pull a lot of energy to the immune system and you're gonna feel the exhaustion effects after. And that is exactly what a food coma is. So as comfortable and sleepy as it may be, it's inflammation trying to kill you. Okay, a little bit of an exaggeration on that last part. But it is inflammation and it's definitely not good for your body. Okay guys, so in order to dampen down postprandial inflammation, I'm just gonna call it post-meal inflammation to make things easier. In order to dampen that down and to sort of, you know, help out your food coma a little bit, there's a few things you can do. And so I'm gonna give you a couple of ways and just remember in your minds that as I always talk about, health isn't, you know, doing one single behavior. It's an accumulation of good behaviors and trying to minimize the bad ones. So select which ones are right for you out of these therapies and just try and do them, you know, when you can. So guys, for these three interventions, they're going to revolve around an amazing protein that your body does create naturally, and it's called lactoferrin. And you've probably never heard of it, but it's one of the most amazing things that your body does to combat chronic illness. Lactoferrin is produced by the body. It's one of the most powerful natural antibiotics we have. It's a universal intervention for inflammatory disorders, and it knows exactly how to differentiate between something that is disease-causing or harmful and something that is not. Because lactoferrin is actually able to tell exactly what's going to harm your body and what's not, it can help to dampen down any unnecessary inflammation that's being produced following a meal just by simply consuming certain foods. So in other words, increasing lactoferrin levels can actually diminish your postprandial, your post-meal inflammatory response and contribute to being an ongoing combat against chronic illness and chronic inflammation. So I'm sure that sounds awesome if you understood all of that. And I want to tell you guys three ways to increase your lactoferrin in order to help reduce your levels of inflammation, reduce those food comas, not feel so exhausted, and reap all of the biological benefits. Okay, so the first way to increase your lactoferrin levels is a little bit strange, but it's actually through breast milk. And breast milk is the most abundant form of lactoferrin in nature. It's got 4 grams of lactoferrin per liter of breast milk. And the reason for this is because when babies are breastfeeding, lactoferrin acts to protect their bodies because their immune system isn't quite fully developed. So it's very, very abundant in breast milk. However, obviously we can't really go and buy human breast milk off the shelves in the grocery store, so it's kind of a strange one. That was, I suppose, more educational, but if you guys are into that, all the power to you. If not, then a lot easier of a way to do it is through supplementation. So lactoferrin is easy to take in a supplement form because of its universal application to a whole bunch of different disease and disorder. It's a lot of practitioners' choices when they don't know exactly where to start with a client. They can start with lactoferrin very often. And so that's a really great supplement. I will link a practitioner-approved lactoferrin supplement below, but it is notable that because lactoferrin is isolated from milk, some people who are lactose intolerant may begin to experience some mild symptoms. It depends sort of the degree of your intolerance, but just keep that in mind. If you are lactose intolerant, lactoferrin may spark a little bit of that up. Okay, so lastly, the healthiest and most economical way to increase your lactoferrin is actually through upper body exercise. evolutionarily, we did a lot of upper body exercise before we would eat. We would climb trees, we would catch fish, do all of these different things that would signal our body that it was mealtime, and that was a signal to produce lactoferrin in order to protect us from any incoming dangers. So unfortunately, now, unless you plan on wrestling your fridge before you eat, you probably aren't gonna get a whole lot of upper body exercise regularly before every single meal like we typically would. But fortunately, evolution hasn't exactly had the time to catch up to this. So by performing just 10 minutes of upper body exercise before you eat your meals, you can actually produce enough lactoferrin to render these immune activations unnecessary, and you can actually dampen down that post-meal inflammation that you're experiencing, which is awesome. I absolutely understand that getting 10 minutes of upper body exercise before every single meal is a little bit crazy. You know, you probably won't do it in the middle of your office or in a restaurant or something like that. But as I said, health is an accumulation of positive behaviors. So if you're doing it just once a day or as often as you feel comfortable with and suits your lifestyle, then that is a great start and can definitely help contribute to reducing your inflammation in the long term. Okay guys, thank you so much for watching. Just a little end note that it's important to remember disease doesn't just pop up overnight. The symptoms typically do, but you know, this biology, this inflammation, it's kind of stewing for a long time. So it is important that we look to these strategies to try and protect our body and keep ourselves healthy in the long run and in the future. So thanks again. I hope you guys learned some great information below. Again, don't forget to subscribe to my channel so that I can help bring all the scientific info directly from research studies to you in the easiest terms that I can. And yeah, I will see you guys in the next video.